गुड आफ्टरनून, वेलकम टू एडुसेट नेटवर्क. फ्रेंड, एज यू नो, वी हैव ऑर्गेनाइज्ड 3 लेक्चर ऑन इंडियन हिस्ट्री. स्टार्टडे वी डिस्कस द डोमिनेंट फीचर करेक्टरिस्टिक ऑफ एंशियंट इंडिया. टुडे वी विल मूव फर्दर एंड विल टॉक अबाउट द मिडिवल इंडिया, एन ओवरव्यू ऑफ मिडिवल इंडिया. एज यू नो, इट स्टार्टेड अराउंड 18th सेंचुरी टू एंड अप टू 18th सेंचुरी. 8th सेंचुरी टू 18th सेंचुरी, अबाउट थाउजेंड ऑफ ईयर्स, एंड इट इज डिफिकल्ट टू discuss all the things what happened in 1000 years in 1 hour. So we will just have an overview of the period. And as you know, there are several events occurred, there are several practices were adopted, and the experiment was done during this period. But our aim is not to explain all of them, but just to introduce it and how you can study all of them in a new perspective. So we will just have an overview of the these periods. And for discussion on this very topic, we have in the studio Professor Tripti Dev. She is Assistant Professor in Hindu College, Delhi University, and teaches medieval India there, and has long experience of social history of the country. She is a young scholar, forward-looking, progressive, but has chosen topic of medieval India, has done good work of Wardi community and Charan community in Rajasthan. So has tried to look at the things in from modern perspective to medieval India. So I hope certainly we'll get a new perspective on this topic. So on your behalf, I welcome Professor Tripti Dev for lecture on this very topic. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, viewers. It's quite a challenging task to kind of take you through this long span of time, the medieval history from 8th to 18th century. So my aim today is to just give you an overview and just introduce some topics to you, some important debates and historiographical details, some references which will help you understand this topic better. Now, the history of 8th to 18th century, especially the early medieval part of history, is actually rounded on the debate on feudalism. So if you can see the slide, which talks about the few different aspects of interpreting an early medieval period, which is primarily a very complex study, which is on the debate on feudalism. Characterizing 8th to 18th century will be done through the debate. The processes of state formation in North India, which is primarily the formation of rise of Rajputs, and South India, the Cholas, the Chola Empire in the South India. The agrarian and different form of trade and forms of exchange, and also the religious and cultural developments prevalent. So this period will be primarily the 8th to the 12th century, which is a period of many dynasties, literally. So let me just help you understand that what was this period like in terms of the historiography. The period after post-Guptas and also before coming of Muhammad Ghazni is been characterized differently by historians. For example, D.D. Kosambi talked about feudalism but did not really follow strictly the way it was studied. He said that feudalism in India was different. R.S. Sharma, who was one of the main historians and a propagator and who has propounded the theory of feudalism, talks about feudalism in India. Scholars like Harbans Mukhya have really critiqued R.S. Sharma and has talked about that the fact that there was no feudalism, and he has different points to say of how the peasantry was free, there was growing trade, there was no dark age, there was no Kali age. Also, if you B.C. Satkar, who is another great historian, remarked that R.S. Sharma is probably confusing between landlordism and feudalism. He also says that R.S. Sharma has a very Eurocentric view of feudalism in India, which is not a very historical way of understanding the early part of medieval history. B.N.S. Yadav also agreed with the theory of presence of feudalism along with R.S. Sharma, and has tried to fill the gaps that are pointed out in R.S. Sharma's theory. A group of historians like B.D. Chattopadhyay, who's talked about integrative model, Herman Kulke, Champaka Lakshmi, Romila Thapar, they completely deny the feudalism theory and talk about certain different aspects of early medieval period, like the processes of state formation, the growth of new urban centers, the growth of local lineages in form of Rajputs, also free peasantry, emergence and integration of new groups, also the way the Brahmanical ideology functioned. They were trying to acculture and integrate the different social categories, which includes the untouchables, the Shudras, and this led to a different kind of integration of local cults through festivals, through rituals, thus legitimizing them and getting them in the social hierarchy. Bertenstein, more so vis-a-vis the Chola Empire, talks about the segmentary state model. So he talks about the fact that state included of several segments, self-operating peasants segment. Temples were important institution in South India for development of their state formation, as the entire state developed around the temple. Temple was actually a very important mechanism, and there's an n number of studies on the temples of South India. Also, if you really see, the Nadus and the Nagarams are important aspects. The Nagarams were more importantly the urban groups, the trade groups. Nadus were the centers of the social unit. And also the specialization of trade and merchant guilds. So these are some of the important points that one can keep in mind while discussing interpreting the early medieval period. The religious and cultural developments that I had highlighted in the slide talked about also can be spoken vis-a-vis the Sufism and the Bhaktism, the way it emerged in the Indian subcontinent from the 9th century. Now going further, I would like to take you now to discussing the extent of the Sultanate, the early sultans. So the extent, if you really see, is coming from the northwest frontiers, the Kashmir, the areas up the Yadavas. This is broadly the extent of the early sultans. Early sultan, that means before the Khalji Empire. Now, briefly, Muhammad Ghazni and Mahmud Ghazni and Ghurid. Basically, if you see the slide, the period from 990 to 1015 was a period of protracted struggle. Gradually, Afghanistan, Punjab and Multan were lost to Ghaznavids, and the way was now open to Turkish advance in the Gangetic Plains. 1163 is also known as known important for Ghiyasuddin Muhammad, who assumed the throne of Ghur. Now, most of the historians have discussed this entire invasion as a more of a narrative, and a more of a, for example, Mill and R.C. Majumdar talks about, he treats Muhammad Ghazni and his Indian campaign as events of plundering, iconolistic raids in harmony. And with this characterized, he actually characterized it in terms of a Muslim protagonist. On the other hand, Marxist historiography discussed by Muhammad Habib talks about a more scientific view of this invasion, so which is a more objective reading that underlines economic rationale behind the temple looting that Ghazni and Ghur did. John F. Richards further in his study develops an argument of slow moving frontiers from the 7th to about the 13th century. So this also characterizes the early medieval period. Now, Battle of Tarain, the first Battle of Tarain, and the second Battle of Tarain, of course, is famous for Prithviraj Chauhan and his defeat in the hands of Turk. Now, while discussing the next topic of rise of Turks, now the rise of Turks basically is discussed as a Muslim invasion. Now there's a big debate in the historical circle about whether it was a Muslim invasion or a Turkish invasion or the Indian foreign debate. Now the sources primarily that we study for understanding this debate is the textual, the literary sources, and also the inscriptional sources, which are quite less. When I discuss the defeat of Rajputs and the hands of Turk, I would like to discuss some of the causes for the defeat of Rajputs. So briefly, my next slide will show the reasons for the defeat of Rajputs, which is the political disunity of North India, since the North India had several dynasties and there was a constant bickering and political disunity. The military reason can be the equipments, technology and strategies of warfare, the notions and the rules of warfare that were better among the Turks than the rulers in India. The society, the Indian society, which was ruled by the caste system, further weakened and made it easier for the Turks to invade. And overall culture of North India, for example, the religion and values derived from religion, for example, the idea of notion of karma and fate, actually determined, made the fighters less determined to fight back after they lost. because they thought that it is their fate and karma. So all these situations really were the reasons which have been historically attributed to the defeat of Rajputs. Now, going to the Delhi Sultanate Empire, let me give you a brief overview of the political chronology. My next slide, which is Qutbuddin Aibak, the first is to 1206 to 1210, Iltutmish, Ruknuddin Firoz, Razia 1236 to 40, Behram Shah 1240 to 42, Nasiruddin Mahmud Shah 46 to 66, Balban from 1266 to 87, and 1290, which is the watershed year, which is the end of Turks and beginning of Khaljis. Now, Khaljis and Tughlaqs, also right now I would like to take show you the chronology. Khalji's rule was from 1290 to 1320, and Tughlaq's were from 1320 to 88. Khalji's include Jalaluddin Khalji, 1290 to 96, Alauddin Khalji, Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, Muhammad bin Tughlaq, Firoz Tughlaq, 1351 to 88. And now, if you let me also show you the map by and large in my next slide, which talks about which actually will help you understand the geographical extent of these rulers. Now, when Aibak came, now this slide, the first slide, the first map, the dark maroon is the region which Aibak was able to conquer and consolidate. And Iltutmish after, who was a slave of Aibak and was the, actually known as the Sultan of, the first Sultan of the Delhi Sultanate, has a broader region who in consolidation with him. Now, going to Balban, in the next map is in the orange, and Alauddin Khalji, the area gradually, if you see, and then Muhammad bin Tughlaq going further Deccan increases. So the span of Delhi Sultanate by and large is increasing with Muhammad bin Tughlaq, by the end of Muhammad bin Tughlaq and Firoz Shah Tughlaq. But if you really see the later Tughlaqs in the third map, and the Sayyid dynasty, the Sayyid and the Lodi dynasty, actually became very, very, the geographical area became very, very small, and there was a disintegration in terms of other kingdoms like Bahamani, the Vijayanagara, which now become very important in the scenario of the political scenario of the Mughal of the Delhi Sultanate period. Now, also in the next slide is the Khilji dynasty map, which is in the pink is the Khilji dynasty, which is most part of the North India and the Doab region, the Tughlaq dynasty, which is now fairly in the Deccan and the south. Now, after showing you so many slides and maps, I would just like to briefly take some issues which are related to Tughlaqs, the Khaljis, and the early Delhi Sultanate rulers. The important aspect of when you're discussing the Khaljis and the Tughlaqs and the early emperors, the early Delhi Sultanate rulers, is the role of nobility. Now, nobles were literally the kingmakers. The early sultans, in fact, Irfan Habib has given this term ruling classes to the nobility and the nobility of early sultans, which remained an important category. They were manipulative, they were dominant, they were smart to actually have their rulers put into place, especially with the early Delhi Sultanate rulers. They were given important titles like the Maliks, the Khans, and also Malik and the Khans were important groups who were in the high post, administrative post of in the Delhi Sultanate nobility, and important titles like Khwaja Jahan, Imat-ud-Dawla, Nizam-ul-Mulk, etc. were given. Now, the Turks considered, the early sultans who were the Turks, considered themselves superior to other races like the Tajiks, the Khaljis, Afghans, Hindustanis, etc. So they were very, very careful and very, very particular about the race that they were about, and the race that they were employing, and the kind of sultanate ruler and the nobility that they were engaged into. Under the Khaljis and Tughlaqs, however, the Indian Muslims forged ahead. there was broadening of the nobility. There were other groups which were became important in the nobility. The nobility gradually broadened and became more stabilized under the Khaljis and the Tughlaqs. So the Khaljis and Tughlaqs, that's the reason if you really see, by the time, if you see the Tughlaq dynasty slide that I have in front of me, if you really see that the expansion of the Mughal, the Delhi Sultanate has happened far to the Deccan area also. So which will include and encompass a greater nobility and greater governing class. Now, going further, Balban, who became an important Sultanate ruler after a lot of mechanisms that he had undertaken to become the ruler, becomes important far more because of Bharani, who's made the theory of kingship around him. Now, Bharani, who was in the court of the Balban, had actually sought to increase the power of monarchy and to centralize all authority under the hands of the ruler. Iranian theory of kingship became important, and that was kind of replicated to the Sultanate period, to Balban's theory of functioning in the Delhi Sultanate. The king was the divine or semi-divine in character and answerable only to God. This is the Iranian theory of kingship, which was kind of replicated by Balban through Bharani, who's written about Balban. He was only answerable to God, the ruler, and not to any set of intermediaries, especially to the religious officials. Nobles are dependent on sultans and in no way equal to him. So we see that with this entire theory of kingship, Bharani has put Balban at a pedestal which is unquestionable. And we see that Balban is known for consolidating the rule that the early sultans had till now made. Now, going after Balban, after his long rule, when we talk about the end of the Turkish rule, if you go back to the slide and see 1290 being the watershed mark of the end of Turks and the beginning of the Khalji, it's also characterized as Khalji revolution. Or, you know, other Khaljis are also known for their market reforms, especially Alauddin Khalji is known for his market reforms and agrarian policies. Now, why do we call this as Khalji revolution? This is studied by historians quite deeply. Now, coming of the new tribe, Turkish invasion, Delhi Sultanate, and the coming of new tribe in 1290, the Khaljis, into rule with the decline of Turks. This dynamic development in history of the medieval period is known as the Khalji revolution. Alauddin Khalji primarily is known for his market and agrarian reforms. Efforts that he made were at internal reconstruction, restructuring of the Sultanate. He needed this to control, to have a big army, which could actually defend the Sultanate, the rule, the army, which was to meet the recurrent Mongol invasion that was impending. So Mongols were a tribe which were again and again kind of disturbing the Sultanate rule, and to protect his own empire, Alauddin Khalji knew that he had to have his huge army, and for which the finances had to be in control. And for that, he kind of reformed many ways, and that is the one reason that he had this market policy. He also controlled market prices, brought the entire Doab into the Khalisa region. Now, the Khalisa region, of course, I'm sure all of you know about the region which is in direct control of the ruler. He established direct relations with the cultivators. Why? Because he wanted to put greater pressure to displace the Rais and the Ranas, and also tried to curb the privileges of Mukaddams and the Chaudhries. Now, they were important landed magnates who did not really allow the state to actually have the kind of resource and income that they deserved, or they were entitled to, because of the extortion that was happening at the ground level from the peasantry. Alauddin Khalji in his market reforms also controlled prices and appointed in charges of market, and also had very strict punishment mechanisms. Now, the three kind of markets that he actually drew were the grain market, the cloth market, the horse, cattle, and the slave market. Now, coming further after Alauddin Khalji's reforms, I would want to explain a bit about the iktidari system. Now, ikta is a word which means part or portion. The connotation had kept changing. Iktidari system is not a system that was developed by the Delhi Sultanate rulers in India. It was a mechanism that was brought from Central Asia that they had come from. It was already existed. And if we really see from the time of Mohammad Ghor, its connotation, its meaning, the way Ikta functioned, the way the different privileges of Ikta kept on changing. Now, it is a portion of land that is given by the king in lieu of services. Ikta was transferable, and there's a huge debate on the Iktidari system, and many historians, including Moreland and many economic historians, have worked on the Iktidari system. So this would need a little bit of more attention. Probably later on I can discuss this in question and answers. Now, Muhammad bin Tughlaq of the Tughlaq dynasty, which is the last, the third dynasty among the five dynasties in the Delhi Sultanate period, is famous for his experiments, which was the shifting of the capital. The five experiments that Muhammad bin Tughlaq is famous for is briefly the shifting of the capital from Delhi to Deoghir or Daulatabad, and the introduction of the token currency, Khurasan expedition, the Karachil expedition, increase in taxes, and all this. Primarily, the kind of reference that we get is from Isami and Afif, who were the writers, the contemporary writers of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. So they give us and help us understand to read the and understand Tughlaq in his own times. And after Muhammad bin Tughlaq, Firoz Shah Tughlaq, the last ruler of the Tughlaq dynasty, by his time, he's also known for his benevolence rule, because he undertaken a lot of welfare activities like building of canals and irrigation. He had a separate department for agriculture, loans. In fact, Iktidari system, whose main feature is transferable of land, became not transferable. It became hierarchical. So which led to, some historians talk about, the crisis of the Sultanate, because the entire mechanism, the foundation of the Iktidari system kind of was brought into crisis. Firoz Shah Tughlaq is also known for the large amount of slaves that he had in his fort, and the concept of benevolence and people's welfare is associated with Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Now, after discussing the first three, the Delhi's early sultans, the Khalji dynasty, the Tughlaq dynasty, the first three Sultanate dynasties, the watershed was the Timur expansion. Now, the Timur in the next slide, if I can help you understand, Timur came, the disintegration of Delhi Sultanate was hastened by Timur and the sack of Timur, who sacked Delhi in 1398-99. My next slide has a map which will talk about this blue area is towards the right, extreme right side, is the Delhi, the Sultan of Delhi. Now, this was the region which was conquered by this was the region which was sacked by Timur, and the photograph Timur is on the left side. Now, rather than spending so much time on that, I would like to go on further to the next dynasty, which is from 1414 to 51, which is the Sayyid dynasty. And the next is the Lodi dynasty from 1451 to 1526. Lodis are, of course, known for their beautiful architecture. Again, I would not like to spend too much time on this, but would like to tell you briefly about that they were in this period, around the 15th century and towards the early part of the 16th century, there were many regional powers around the Indian subcontinent which kind of were growing, and there was this regional formation that was happening in eastern India, for example in Bengal, Assam, Orissa. In western India, there was Gujarat, Malwa and Mewar which were developing. In the northwest and North India, there were the Sharki dynasty, the Lodi sultans, and the Kashmir region, which was developing in its political unity and political state formation. Now, the common characteristics of all these regional formations was that all of them developed strong polities with rich cultural traditions known specifically even till today. Sufism, for example, developed in Bengal, Kashmir, etc. Many literary works were also compiled in the courts of regional kingdoms. So, if we get to study this particular period from the 15th and the early part of the 16th century, it will be important and it will be interesting to study these regions specifically. And then we would understand how distinctly they developed their own cultures in this period. My next slide will briefly help you understand the Vijayanagara Empire, which is of course not the north. It is towards in the peninsular, the Krishna, the Godavari belt. The map of Vijayanagara, the blue, the portion colored in blue is the Vijayanagara Empire, 1336 to 1646. And Vijayanagara Empire, especially known for the Krishna Deva Rai's rule, the famous emperor, and some of the monuments that this empire had. Had actually left legacy of is the Hampi, the Konark, the Sun Konark temple. Now, after that, the Bahamani Empire, the next slide, the Vijayanagara and the Bahamani Empire were in constant conflict for a lot of reasons. This was in the from about Bahamani Empire, in the next slide, we'll talk about 1347, from the 1347 to 1527. So, this is in the orange color in the map is the Bahamani region, the Bahamani Empire. And this particular architecture is a madrasa by Mahmud Kavan, who was actually the famous minister of the Bahamanids, the Bahamani Empire. Now, after discussing, just kind of really not discussing, but briefly explaining what this Vijayanagara Bahamani Empire, I would not like to spend a lot of time on this. I would still like to go on the next slide of mine, which is the first battle of Panipat, the 1526. I'm sure everybody knows, most of the viewers would know about this. Now, this the battle of Panipat was in 1526. Between the Mughal forces of Babur, the Timurid ruler of Kabulistan, defeated the much larger Indian army of Ibrahim Lodi, the Sultan of Delhi. So at this point of time in 1522 to 26, Ibrahim Lodi of the Lodi dynasty was the Sultan of Delhi. And he had to face the conflict with the defeat at the hands of Mughal ruler Babur in 1526. So this slide of mine has a pictorial has a pictorial depiction, the map of where the Panipat was fought, and also the death of Sultan Ibrahim is shown with this painting, who was the last Lodi Sultan of Delhi. Now, after the first battle of Panipat, again is a watershed. It is an important year because from here we study the second aspect of the medieval period. Now, till now I was discussing the Delhi Sultanate period, the early medieval period, the Delhi Sultanate, the rulers in the Delhi Sultanate, what were the important issues in that. Now I would like another next 20 minutes discuss about the Mughal Empire. And Mughal Empire began with the first battle of Panipat, wherein Babur defeated Ibrahim Lodi in 1526 at Panipat. Now, this slide will help you understand the chronology, which is important and to understand. 1550 to 1707 is broadly seen the rule of the Mughals. Humayun from 1530 to 36, Akbar from 1556 to 1605, Jahangir from 1605 to 27, Shahjahan from 1627 to 58, and Aurangzeb from 1650 to 1707. Now, after that, I would like to show you the map of the Mughal Empire, which is by and large under Akbar. If you see, he was the first ruler, the who actually consolidated the rule of the Mughals. The area in pink, the entire north belt, the area of Rajputs, how he allied Rajputs, they're going to the Gujarat area, the Vindhya mountains. Then if I can get the slide back, the extent of the Mughal Empire is actually most of it was consolidated by Akbar, if you can see. And gradually under Shahjahan, Aurangzeb and Jahangir, the most of the expansion, I mean, was undertaken by Akbar. And a bit in the Deccan and towards the Orissa Kalinga region is the work of the later after rulers after Akbar. Now, after discussing the extent and the chronology, let me take up what were the key issues under Akbar. So my next slide would help you understand the key points of Akbar's reign that I would be discussing briefly. The first aspect is about the campaign and consolidation of the empire. The most important thing that we study about Akbar is how he actually fought so many campaigns all across north, south, north, Deccan, east, west, and consolidated the Mughal Empire. It wasn't done so much under Humayun and Babur, Humayun so much because he did not have the time. He was, of course, defeated by Sher Shah Suri for a short while. But primarily, the 60% of the work, 70% of the work was done, consolidated by Akbar. The second point that I would like to discuss here is the administrative system, the Zapti, the Mansabdari and the Jagirdar in the Umara system. Umara is the nobility, actually. And also some of the other issues that I would like to take up in this short while is the ruling elites, the next, the third pointer, and the religious policy of Akbar, which includes the Ibadat Khana, some of the important developments in his religious policy that historians discuss is Ibadat Khana, Mehzar, Sulah-e-Kul, and Abul Fazl's theory of kingship and relations that Akbar had with Rajput kingdom. So my entire the next 5 minutes, I would be discussing on these themes. Humayun, who was the successor after Babur, was actually ousted by Sher Shah in the battle. And when after he came back from his exile, he had a very short time to build the Mughal Empire. So the first conflict that we see is when the first consolidation of the Mughal Empire is under Akbar. And Akbar, his first conflict was with Himu, the Afghan ruler. He had to deal with, Akbar also had to deal with Uzbek rebellion in the 1580. His early expansions include the region of Malwa, the Gharkatanga, Rajasthan, Gujarat. So if I'll show you the extent again, the map in my slide, the entire region of Malwa, Gharkatanga, Rajasthan, Gujarat, Eastern India, and then later Northwest. Later into the Deccan, he went up to the Ahmednagar, parts of Ahmednagar were taken, Berar, Khandesh, and also Bijapur and Golconda had accepted Mughal sovereignty. So this is by and large what is discussed, what is the campaigns and the conquest of Akbar. Now, in terms of historical debate, this particular campaign conquest is seen as the gunpowder firearm theory by Akhtar Alam Khan, and it is an important study, when it is an important debate that one should keep in mind and study the military technology of Akbar's army when we are discussing this particular campaign and conquest. Now, when the Zapti system, in the administrative system, the Zapti is the mode of assessment. This was a mode of assessment that was kind of desired to be employed in the Mughal Empire. The Mansabdari system, which is actually the administrative steelwork, Shirin Musbi to quotes saying it, that it was the steel framework of the Mughal Empire. The Mansabdars were the officials who were appointed directly by the Mughal ruler, were paid directly by the Mughal ruler, and the Mansabdars were actually the ruling elites. They were the nobles. They were actually the bureaucracy of the Mughal Empire. The Jagirdari system is a system according to which the Jagir lands were given in lieu of services. For example, a Mansabdar who is giving a service to the Mughal Empire, the Mughal Emperor, will get his remuneration salary through a Jagir land, a portion of land from which he can have his revenue, a set revenue, a salary that he needs to be taking it, or in form of nakadi cash. Now, one has to be very careful in understanding that when he has the right on the revenue, the Mansabdar, when he gets a Jagir or he becomes a Jagirdar as a Mansabdar, he has the right over the revenue and not on the land. The land ownership rights is still with the tiller. So this is another very important debate and discussion which is very interesting to study. And all this, the Zapti, the Mansabdari, the Jagirdari, the Umara, the nobility, is kind of very well intertwined in the study of the economic history, the political history of the Mughal Empire. Now, going further to the ruling elites. Ruling elites were, of course, the nobility, and one of the best works is by Athar Ali, who's worked on the nobility of the Mughal Empire. The religious policy of Akbar can be discussed in three phases, and Satish Chandra discusses this in his book. The early phase of Akbar is demonstrated with broad-mindedness, because we see abolition of jizya in 1563. The pilgrimage tax was being abolished, was abolished in 1564. But in private, you know, historians have discussed that in his private conduct, Akbar was an Orthodox Muslim. Now, the second phase was characterized, the religious policy was characterized of Akbar with institution building like Ibadat Khana, which was a discussion forum for different religious thinkers, and which was in 1575. Later, it was actually closed. Mezar was a document which was introduced wherein if there was any conflict in the religious world, the ruler had his authority. So this was the document which declared this, which is introduced in 1579. So Faizi was the one who had Sheikh Mubarak, had drafted this particular document. The final phase of religious policy can be studied in terms of Akbar's own ideas being developed in the religious aspect, and his own ideas and belief, which we study under Tawhid-e-Ilahi, that is uncompromising monotheism, Deen-e-Ilahi, Sulh-e-Kul, peace for all. So this is a very interesting debate, again very interesting discussion, which will need attention probably some other time. And Abul Fazl, who was the court chronicler of Akbar, known for his work Ain-e-Akbari, actually, again, like the way Barani had drafted the theory of kingship of Balban, Abul Fazl had written the theory of kingship for Akbar. So he was the one who was the architect of Akbar's ideas. He was the one who actually drew the blueprint of Akbar's ideas. Many historians discuss that. Now, it is also another important study while we're discussing Akbar to see his relation with the Rajputs. Now, Rajputs being a very important and a formidable force in the Indian subcontinent, were important to be allied. And how through matrimonial alliances, through different mechanism, Akbar was able to really have Rajputs become party in the rulership and not kind of have conflict with them. Now, after discussing Akbar very briefly, I would like to now understand, make you understand about the key points under the Jahangir reign. Now, under Jahangir's reign, we see that the key points of Jahangir's reign in my next slide is the extension of Mughal rule, and we also see relations of with the regional elites, the changes in the Mansabdari system with the introduction of Diospa, Siospa, the Nur Jahan Junta, Nur Jahan who's the empress, the wife of Jahangir, and Jahangir's interest in paintings. Jahangir actually, in terms of extending the Mughal rule, had extended rule till Mewar, East India and Kangra. Now, Nur Jahan Junta, let us understand this. It's a very interesting, again, a very interesting issue that one studies and historians debate on while discussing Jahangir, is what is it Nur Jahan Junta? Nur Jahan, of course, we know is the wife of Jahangir, and Nur Jahan Junta is a term that was given by this modern historian, Dr. Beni Prasad, and he forwarded this theory of Junta, which consisted of people who were immediately close, who were the associates of Nur Jahan. It was literally Nur Jahan's family which was ruling during Jahangir's reign. So how? So if you see Nur Jahan's role and impact on the court politics of Mughal court under Jahangir is being really debated by historians. Itmat-ud-Dowlah, who was the father of Nur Jahan, Asaf Khan, who was the brother, benefited from Nur Jahan's marriage to Jahangir. Father was given, Itmat-ud-Dowlah was given high post of Wizarat, and the brother who was Asaf Khan was the Mir Bakshi. Also, if we see Khurram, who was later Shah Jahan, had married Nur Jahan's daughter Arjun Banu. So it was Shah Jahan, it was Khurram, who was later Shah Jahan, the ruler or the next ruler in the Mughal hierarchy, Itmat-ud-Dowlah, Nur Jahan, Asaf Khan. They were the ones who were actually ruling in the name of Jahangir. So that's the reason we call this as a junta. That means the family, literally Nur Jahan's family, kind of ruling and during this time. Now, changes in Mansabdari system that I had given a pointer is introduction of Diuspa, Siuspa. Also, if we see the paintings, how important were the paintings? In fact, paintings were the most important during Jahangir. Jahangir was not so much interested in architecture. Rather, he was more fond of paintings. Painters like Manohar, Bichitra, Abul Hasan were in the court of Jahangir. Jahangir had interest in symbolic paintings, naturalism. He liked to paint flora and fauna. Miniature paintings became important. There were finer lines, broader were richer, borders were richer. Copying actually became a very reached its height during Jahangir's time. So there is more that we can study on the Jahangir painting that probably we'll need some other. So if I'm not able to explain so much on Jahangiri painting, but my next few slides will explain or help you understand how beautifully Jahangir's paintings were. So the second painting on the right is Jahangir holding the globe, and my next slide, which is again the depiction of royalty and the Mughal household, the Mughal emperor's demeanor is through these beautiful paintings during Jahangir's time. Now, after discussing Jahangir and his painting, I would like to discuss some key points of Shahjahan's reign, the next ruler in the hierarchy. Now, Shahjahan was actually, my next slide has some few pointers on what important points that I would like to discuss on Shahjahan. Shahjahan was the architect, was interested in architecture and was actually known as the builder of the Mughal Empire. There were also certain changes that we see in the Mansabdari system, and Mansabdari system in terms of introduction of month scales during Shahjahan's reign, Mansabdar also grew 4 times more. And why is Shahjahan called the sky, the builder of the Mughal Empire? Of course, that is clear from the point that there are so many, in fact Delhi itself has so many architectural depictions of Shahjahan's reign. So Shahjahan had sky touching buildings. So usage of white marble, if we see in these two, the left, on the left side is the Taj Mahal, the right side are the two cenotaphs of Shahjahan and Mumtaz Mahal, the Qabr of the ruler and the wife in the center of the Taj Mahal. And the usage of white marble, if I can get the slide back on Shahjahan's architecture, Taj Mahal, the usage of white marble, elevated platforms, which gives it a bigger look, magnanimous, grandeur look. The capital of Shahjahanabad, which was built by Shahjahan, the surface decoration and multicolored semi-precious stones were also used, the Pitra Diora work, and there were better arches and bulbous domes. Some of these were the features of the Mughal architecture. So the Red Fort, the Jama Masjid in Delhi are all depictions of elevated platforms, usage of white marble, bulbous domes and better arches. And now certain changes in the Mansabdari system under Shahjahan was the introduction of month scales. Also, there was increase in the nobility, and Athar Ali has discussed with understanding the composition of nobility. Why was it becoming more composite? Why was it becoming more heterogeneous in its character is discussed by Athar Ali. So if one wants to read about the nobility and the evolution of nobility, I think it will be a good idea to kind of take a look at Athar Ali's text on the Mughal nobility. My next issue that I would like to take another next 5 minutes is Aurangzeb, the last interesting ruler and most controversial ruler, and there are several key points that I would like to discuss here on Aurangzeb. Now, Aurangzeb's first important issues when historians start discussing him is the war of succession that happened. The war of succession, which was among the four brothers, Darash in 1658-59, Darashiko Shuja, who was the governor of Bengal, Bihar, Orissa, Aurangzeb himself, who was the governor of Deccan provinces, Murad, who was the governor of Gujarat and Malwa. So there was this war of succession and a series of wars and battles that were fought under this war of succession, which is interpreted and debated by many historians, and it was fought in 1658-59. Also, the relation that Aurangzeb had with the ruling elites, if I can get my slide back on the key points of Aurangzeb, the second pointer discusses the relations with the ruling elite. So that means how was Aurangzeb with his people? So we see that there was breach with Marwar, Mewar. There were popular revolts by Jats, Satnamis, Afghans and Sikhs. Vis-a-vis the nobility, the third point, there was an expansion of nobility. As we see that there was inclusion of Marathas and the Deccani nobles. Also, in terms of Deccan campaigns, we see Aurangzeb conquered Bijapur, Golconda between 1658 and 87. Rise of Marathas under Shivaji became a constant nuisance rather for the Mughal emperor Aurangzeb to consolidate his rule in Deccan. So we see constant conflict between the Marathas and the Mughal rule under Aurangzeb. Vis-a-vis the last point of religious policy under Aurangzeb, we see that historians like from the Aligarh school, historians like Jyotirnath Sarkar, S.R. Sharma, Athar Ali Satish Chandra have discussed different aspects and issues that become important. Again, very, very important debate is about Aurangzeb's religious policy. So we do this through understanding that were there mass conversions? Was there temple destruction? Was there steps that Aurangzeb took which were orthodox? So there's a big debate on Aurangzeb and his religious policy. Was he really a religious by God or he was a tolerant ruler? So there are a lot of issues that needs a special attention on this. My next slide is very briefly on the economy which will include the rural and the urban setup. The agrarian structure of the Mughals includes the issues that can be studied are ownership and rights, land revenue system, the village communities, zamindars, peasants and the rural tensions. Some of the books that you can refer is B.R. Grover, Nurul Hasan, W.H. Moreland, Irfan Habib, Shireen Muzvi. So these are some of the historians who have really discussed on the agrarian structure. So I will not have the time to kind of take this up topic separately right now, but probably you can take a look at the references then. Vis-a-vis the trade, we can study the trade in Mughal Empire with three important phases. The first phase is the domination of Portuguese. The second is the domination of several nations operating on competitive basis, free competition. And the third is the East India Company, English East India Company's monopoly. Vis-a-vis the next aspect of society and culture in the Mughal period, the next slide, some of the important themes that one can look at are the Persian as a language and how it became an important tool of transmission in the court of Mughals. Persian literature, in which there are many histories, memoirs and travelogues that have been written. Imperial architectural traditions, the regional developments and the paintings and visual culture. See, these are some of the issues that must be taken and studied historiographically when we are discussing society and culture. Now, my second last issue that I would like to discuss under the Mughals is the Marathas. Marathas, in the next slide, briefly in four pointers, came into prominence in Deccan with the Bahamani kingdom, in which they played a crucial role in the 16th century. The movement to carve out Maratha state was led by Shivaji in the 17th century. Shivaji's administration and army is also an important debate, an important study among the historical historians. Marathas further can be studied well under the Peshwas in the first half of the 18th century under Balaji Vishwanath, Bajirao I and Balaji Bajirao. I would like to end my today's lecture by the 18th century debate. So I began with a debate of the feudalism in the 8th century, and I would like to end with the 18th century debate, which is still a very important debate in the history of medieval India. There were two critical transitions that had changed the structures of power in the 18th century. First, the transition in the first half of the century from Mughal political economy to the regional political orders, like Awadh, Bengal, the successor states that we call about. And the second transition is the period, if I can get my slide back, the period following the battles of Plassey 1757 and Battle of Buxar in 1764. In the polity, society, economy, as English East India Company steered its way to a position of political prominence in North India. So 18th century is the dark age, continuity, change debate that historians discuss. For example, Satish Chandra and Bailey as a revenue historian, Rajat Datta, Professor Rajat Datta. So there are many historians who have kind of contributed to 18th century debate. Now, 18th century debate also becomes an important watermark to a watershed century to take it further to the modern period. So 18th century is also an overlapping period between the medieval, the clear-cut divisions that sometimes historians are uncomfortable to use, like the medieval, the modern categories. So basically 18th century is a period which is an interesting century to be studied from social, economic, cultural, political, spiritual, religious context by both medieval and the modern historians. I would like to discuss more if there is anything that needs to be taken up in question and answers. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
So one question that appears, because we saw the entire Mughal period, there was fight between one another. So was it a political driven period, or you can say the economic drive of things? What was the things? Politics, society, or economy? What was the predominant drive?
I think any period in history, or present or future, or past, present, future, the three timelines, realms, is conditioned by polity, society, economy, everything. So I think it is important to study the period holistically, rather than understanding it just from a very broad point of view of what was one issue of conflict.
Okay.
So I think all issues were important and determinants to understand the conflict and the reasons for conflict.
Okay.
Yeah.
One more question I'd like to ask you, because I have come across many students, they find it difficult to understand the Mansab system, Mansabdari system. Can you just elaborate the Mansabdari system so that the student will get benefited out of this?
Sure. So Mansabdari system is many students discuss this as an important administrative framework that Akbar had created to have this bureaucracy which he put into place through officials whom he called mansabs or mansabdars, and they were ranks given to them, and maximum a mansabdar could get was, especially in the royal household, was the 5,000 zatsa. So the mansabdar had two ranks, zat and the savar rank. The zat was the personal rank, and savar was the military rank that he had. Again, the savar rank could never increase if we compare it to the zat rank. So a savar rank can never be increased, but savar rank can be increased sometimes in conditional systems.
Okay.
Also, there has been issues in among historians on that, how there has been a problem of the understanding when was it introduced.
Yeah.
So W.H. Morland, Shirin Musvi, and Ifan Habib have discussed when was it introduced. So again, I would not like, that's a long debate, all still ongoing. But Mansabdari system undoubtedly, unanimously, has been understood as a bureaucracy work.
Okay. And yeah. What about its success? Was it successful, or it was just proved to be ephemeral, and just we can say the short period of time it solved the problem?
It did, because I think the need of that time was to have a bureaucracy which could which could function in terms of having a close relation with the ruler as well as with the people. So I think Mansabdari system was a very interesting and a very strong mechanism which was put in place to have the Mughal Empire's administrative system going. In fact, some historians discuss that it was the crisis in the Mansabdari system that actually led to the crisis during the Shahjahan's and Aurangzeb reign, that actually led to the crisis of the Mughal Empire. So it was that important.
Okay.
So Shirin Musvi talks about it being the steel framework of the Mughal Empire.
Mm-hmm.
So,
So it also, in a way, contributed to the fall of the Mughal Empire, you can
Some
say.
historians discuss that
Okay.
that it was so important. It's like the present Indian bureaucracy. If the IAS, IFS, IPS officers stop functioning in today's context, everything will come to a standstill. So that is the way the bureaucracy functioned, and
Okay.
it was that important.
Okay,
Yeah.
so what need to be read by the student to understand this system in detail? Just we will end with this.
The
What do you suggest? Yeah.
Mansabdari system is discussed by almost every historian, but Mansabdari system can be understood by studying any good book on Mughal history. One can study W.H. Moreland, one can study Irfan Habib, Shirin Muzvi, and Mansabdari system can also be studied from actually these historians and
Okay.
other interpretations. I think there is an array of, it does, it's not occurring in my mind right now, but
Okay.
there is an array of work that has been done on
Okay.
Mansabdari system. Yeah.
So, well, friends, Professor Tripti Deo has explained the very briefly all the things, the number of events that took place during the Mughal period, Delhi Sultanate period, and other kingdoms which flourished that times. So I hope this lecture have certainly given you a kind of framework in which you can do a study, because it introduced you and also helped you to find out where the main thing was located, through which you can generate your own interpretation and have own perspective. So I hope this lecture must will have impact on you and will give you a direction to read the Mughal period and you can say the entire medieval periods in a new way. So with this, we conclude the lecture. I thank all of you for watching the lecture, and on your behalf, I thank Professor Tripti Dev for giving
Thank
such
you.
an insightful lecture on this medieval India overview. Thank you very much.
Thank you.